الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah and may Allah's peace and blessings be on the last Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and on all those who follow the path of righteousness until the last day. The topic, addressing cultural Islam, is a critical concept that the Muslim world has to deal with in this time. This is the biggest challenge that we are faced with: cultural Islam. From the perspective of the West, the Muslim world is a challenge. It represents the only civilization that has an alternative to Western civilization. All of the other societies, communities, have been absorbed by Western civilization. They have accepted those values and the norms that have been set by Western secular civilization. It is only the Muslim civilization that stands in their way to true globalization of Western civilization. However, though in their eyes we represent, the Muslim world represent a barrier or a hurdle which stops that globalization process, the fact of the matter is that due to problems that we are faced with internally, we don't really pose a threat. As the Muslim Ummah awakens, this is where the threat lies. The awakening in most recent times, from the 80s, 90s, there is an awakening taking place throughout the Muslim Ummah. This is where the greatest threat actually lies. But the mass of Muslims, the vast majority of Muslims, remain asleep in cultural Islamic traditions and rituals and rites. So, we, till today, in spite of the awakening that is taking place, we still have a long way to go to really pose a threat. Resistance, we do pose. Even in the ignorance that is widespread in the Ummah, Muslims in general still feel that Islam is the best way that we should live. So that poses something of a hurdle and keeps the Muslim world in general together as a threat or potential threat in the eyes of the West. So, reality for us is that the prophetic statement in Surah Ali Imran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas, ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah." You are the best nation extracted from among humankind because you command the good and you prohibit evil and you believe in Allah. This statement which Allah made describing the Muslim Ummah is not one which is applicable to us today. We do not command the good globally. The UN commands the good. And we do not prohibit the evil. It is the UN which prohibits the evil. We do believe in Allah. Okay, the last portion. We still have that. But commanding the good and prohibiting the evil, which is the distinguishing characteristic of what belief in Allah should actually produce, we are not engaged in it. In fact, to some degree, Muslims may command the evil and prohibit the good as a result of the influence of cultural Islam. Cultural Islam prevents the Ummah from fulfilling its duty, its role for which Allah has extracted us, has chosen us from amongst humankind. The realities that face the Muslim world today is that the average Muslim is unable to distinguish between what is cultural and what is strictly Islamic. What is cultural, meaning from tradition and custom, and what is specifically from the sources of Islam. For most people, everything that Muslims do is Islam. Whatever Muslims do is what Islam is. That's how they perceive it. So they are unable to distinguish between cultural Islam or, as the Christian missionaries like to refer to it, folk Islam. When you read their writings, they talk about the common practices, they call it folk Islam. This reality is what has to be cleared. People have to be able to make that distinction so that we can get back on Sirat al-Mustaqim. This is the bottom line. Because Sirat al-Mustaqim, that straight path, which we pray for 17 times every day, Sirat al-Mustaqim is based on what? The Quran and the Sunnah. It's not based on cultural Islam and the traditions, etc. It's based on the Quran and the Sunnah. As the Prophet ﷺ had told us, "Taraktu fikum amrain," I've left with you two things. "In tamassaktum bihima," if you hold on firmly to them, "lan tadillu abada," you will never go astray. You'll never go astray from Sirat al-Mustaqim. Most Muslims accept Quran and Sunnah. Yes, we do have some people who are what they call Quraniyun. We have them, Parvezis in Pakistan, and they've popped up in Malaysia and other places too. People who say we should just follow Quran. This Sunnah is stuff made up hundreds of years after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. We can't rely on it. But they represent a very small number. Vast majority of Muslims, they recognize Quran and Sunnah, yes. Quran, this is our book, we read it. Revelation from Allah, the word of God. And the Sunnah, what Muhammad SAW did, we recognize that, yes, this is Islam. However, if we point out to them, brother, sister, what you are actually doing here is not in accordance with the Sunnah. Prophet Muhammad SAW, he did something else. Here is Sahih Bukhari, here is Sahih Muslim, here is what the Sahaba said that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did. When we say this to people who are cultural Muslims, traditional Muslims, they cannot accept this. They will start to express, you know, concern about the forefathers. They will say, well, were our forefathers wrong? Well, this is what my parents did. This is what my grandparents were doing. This is what my great-grandparents were doing. So what are you saying here? They're all wrong? They're astray? It's only you that's on the right path? This is the attitude that people tend to turn to. Basically, they're saying, you know, hey, if it was good for my parents and grandparents, then it's good for me. It's enough for me. I don't need anything else. Because they were good people. They prayed, they fasted, they did all the things. So, now this attitude is not new. We might find it frustrating, those of us who have come into a new understanding of what Islam is. We might find it frustrating, you know, why are people saying this? Why are they doing this? Why are they taking this attitude? Actually, know that it is not new. It is ancient. It's actually recorded in the Quran in a number of chapters. Among them, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, 5th chapter, verse 104, Allah says there, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ قَالُوا حَسْبُنَا مَا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهِ أَبَاءَنَا. If you tell them, come to what Allah has revealed and to the Messenger, they will reply, what we found our parents doing is sufficient for us. It's enough. That's what the Quraysh said to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when he tried to bring the message of Tawheed to them. They said, no. What our foreparents were doing was enough for us. So this is not a new attitude. So don't be disheartened if you run into this issue within your family, your close relatives. As you find out about Islam and you try to share it with them, you've run into this time and time again. So don't be disheartened. Just be patient with it. Know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to face it. So if he had to face it, who are we to complain? So, if we look at having that level of understanding, we look at this process of cultural Islam and its sources, because for us to deal with it, we need to understand its sources, to understand the principles behind those different positions which are taken. What makes up cultural Islam? Well, first and foremost, cultural Islamic practices may be ancient, before Islam, pre-Islamic practices that people were doing in a particular place when Islam came to them, the people accepted Islam and they brought these practices in with them. This is a natural process. This happens. It's to be expected. If the people learned enough about Islam, then they're able to leave those practices where they went against the Sharia. Because actually, Islam is not against culture. Reality, Islam didn't come to wipe out human culture and replace it altogether. No. It came to guide human beings. And naturally, some of our cultural practices may have no implications on our practice of Sharia. They're just preferences of people in particular places at particular periods of time. And Islam doesn't say, well, no, you can't have these preferences. No. So we have in Islamic law a principle called urf. Urf represents the custom of the people. So where there is an established custom, and it doesn't go against Islamic law, then it is accepted within the system, the legal system of Islam, in that particular area. Now, the point is though, if you have enough Islamic knowledge, then you can make that distinction between urf, which is acceptable, and urf, which is not. That's the point. You have to have knowledge to be able to do it. You can't just go according to, I think, I feel, this should be okay, I feel good when I do it. This is not the basis by which we determine what is acceptable customs and traditions and what are not. This is the point. So there has to be knowledge in order to be able to make this distinction. But we who have this consciousness have to be aware of this process, and not to oppose it in all of its shapes and forms, but only in the forms that go against Islamic teachings. So, for example, pre-Islamic practice in the subcontinent. If we look at a Hindu wedding in India and Pakistan, and we look at a Muslim wedding, you maybe have a hard time distinguishing between the two. Very similar. Though the teachings are quite different, but the traditions are very similar. So, for example, in India, and to a large degree in Pakistan, when women get married, they wear red wedding dresses. The color red is critical. If a woman wants to get married in other than the color red, it's a problem. A big problem. You can find something similar in maybe Egypt and Lebanon, Syria, where under Christian influence there, India it's Hindu influence, in that other area it's Christian influence, where they traditionally get married in white wedding dresses. So if you want to get married in a yellow wedding dress or a green wedding dress, you've got a problem. Yeah, people are going to be resisting and struggling with you over this. So, of course, technically speaking, from an Islamic perspective, it doesn't matter. Islam has not prescribed a particular color that wedding dresses should be. It's left it to people. But the only problem that comes up is the issue where the Prophet ﷺ had said, "Man tashabbaha biqawmin fahuwa minhum." Whoever imitates a people is of them. Meaning you are likely to absorb not only the way that they dress, but also many other things that they do. You will become indistinguishable from them. Muslims should be distinguishable. And we see so many things the Prophet ﷺ instructed us to do to distinguish ourselves from non-Muslims. So from this perspective, we can say that yes, a red wedding dress is not against Islamic teachings, but in India, where people have made it an obligation, then this is the place where they need to break that tradition. In Lebanon and Syria, Egypt, where it's a white, then we need to break that tradition and do it in other colors. Because people have made it an obligation, almost a religious obligation. So those types of practices we need to tackle. Especially, one might say, but this is very minor. You know, what's the harm? It's so small. But if you see what comes along with it, in India, they have a necklace called a tali. And this necklace is from Hindu beliefs and traditions. The tali is shirk. And the women who wear the red dresses make sure that they wear the tali. So the problem wasn't in the red dress, but when they brought along with it the tali, then you really have an hour problem. In the case of those who are in the white, okay, the white was one problem, but then they brought along with it wedding rings and engagement rings, right? And the wedding ring goes on this finger. This is the wedding ring finger. And if you saw the marriage of Princess Diana, you can go on YouTube and get it. When the bishop was conducting the ceremony, he takes the ring from Prince Charles, and he puts it by her thumb and he says, "In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Amen." So this wearing of that ring on that finger is affirmation of the Trinitarian belief in three gods. So that's when it now becomes serious, particularly serious, because it's affecting now our belief system. We have accepted this practice and this comes along with it. So we do have to hold our ground in some of these matters. And one might still say, still that's kind of light, you know, it's not really like life-threatening. You know, it's just, it's off, but the people who are doing it, they don't believe in the Trinitarian idea. Well, if we consider among the practices that people have inherited in Egypt, Sudan, Somalia, in East Africa, Kenya, what is now called female genital mutilation, where women are supposedly circumcised. But it's not circumcision according to Islamic practice, teaching. It is, in truth, female genital mutilation. Now it becomes something really serious because people die from it. They suffer all kinds of ailments, etc. It's horrendous, the consequences of this practice. And it is something that the West points the finger at Muslims for. And they say, look at these Muslims. It distorts the image of Islam, though in fact it's really not a Muslim thing. Because Muslims are 1.7 billion. The total number of Muslims who practice that may be around 500 million countries that practice it. It's a fraction. It is not the majority of Muslims. It is practiced in some areas. Because even of those people in the 500, maybe those who actually practice it are less, much down to 100 or maybe even less. Other parts of the Muslim world never heard about it. If you go to Indonesia and you talk about female genital mutilation, they say, what? They have no idea. Never came across it. Unknown, completely. Malaysia, unknown. Philippines, unknown. So it is limited to one part of the Muslim world, but it has devastating consequences. And it distorts the image of Islam today. And it produces great harm to women. Women are the ones who suffer the most from it. Another example of life-threatening traditions and customs is the Hindu practice of dowry. Dowry in Hindu tradition is given by the family of the female to the male. This is the opposite of the Islamic way. Islamic way, it's the male who gives to the female, showing his preparedness to look after the female. But in Hindu tradition, also in European, old European tradition, it was the family of the female who give money, property, etc. to the male. As a consequence of that practice, it stopped in Europe, but in India it's alive and well. As a consequence of that practice, a phenomenon arose in recent times on a big scale called bride burning. Bride burning. What is bride burning? Well, the family of the girl promises the young man that they're going to marry all kinds of things. After the marriage, the family is not able to do the things that they promised. The young man is complaining, where's my car? Where's my 60-inch television? You know, where's my this? Where's my that? And the young lady is just, you know, my parents, my father, business, whatever, can't do it. So what happens? He conspires with his mother, catches the wife in the kitchen, pours kerosene over her, and sets her on fire. Thousands die every year in India because of that. The government outlawed dowries to try to stop it. But this tradition is deep-rooted. People are not giving it up. It is goes on. Well, we say, okay, that's the Hindus. So what does that have to do with Muslims? Well, there was an article I read in Gulf News in which it said, woman burnt to death in Dhaka. Dhaka is Bangladesh. Mostly Muslims. A greedy husband burned to death his young wife at Sikpara in the city following a feud over dowry, police said. They said Zahir Mia poured kerosene over the body of his wife, Shahnaz, 20 years old, set her on fire on Sunday. She died at Dhaka Medical College Hospital yesterday. It's Muslims. Because Muslims follow that same tradition. As a result, a Muslim sister loses her life. This is a custom, this is a tradition, which has been brought in from Hinduism into Islam. And in Pakistan, I have an article here from Gulf News, in which it said, domestic violence on rise in Pakistan. At least 300 women are burned to death every year. At least 300 women are burned to death every year. They went on to describe it, doused in kerosene and burnt by their close relatives. Similarly, in Egypt, there is a tradition in southern Egypt that if a woman is widowed, she does not remarry. That's just agreed upon. Tradition, custom. A woman is widowed, her husband died, she does not remarry. She remains a widow until she dies. Well, an article in Gulf News, son held for killing mother. In Qina, Egypt, a 22-year-old son beheaded and dismembered his widowed mother when he found out that she had secretly remarried, breaking with tradition in southern Egypt. Police here said yesterday. Salah Ahmed Hassan, helped by one of his uncles, forced Samriya Salam, who is 35 years old, into the village cemetery in Naqada, a hamlet north of the southern resort of Luxor, where they strangled, beheaded, and dismembered the woman, police said. Where did that come from? Can we get any more serious with tradition? This practice was based on a myth. There was a mythological story about the gods of Egypt, right? Where the goddess Isis, according to the myth, her brother desired her. She was already married to Osiris, another of the gods, right? But her own brother, Seth, he desired her for himself as his wife. So he kills Osiris. This is myth. This is myth, mythology. He kills Osiris and expects then that Isis will marry him. But she refuses. Her husband is killed. She's now a widow, but she refuses to marry Seth. Instead, she hides her son, Horus. He's the God who they use the hawk to represent. You'll see the bird in their hieroglyphics with the hawk, the beak. This is Horus. So Horus grows up and he kills Seth. That's the story. Total myth. But what it said is that Isis, widowed, did not remarry. So that cult of Isis, which is different from Isis, you know, the Isis in Syria, and that is a different, this is Isis, real name. The cult of Isis spread over much of Egypt, but its home was in southern Egypt. So that tradition remained extremely strong there. It may be in other parts of Egypt too, but not as strongly as it is in the south. So we can see here that these customs, I mean, there are Muslim people who are practicing this. These customs reach the point of people losing their lives. That's how serious it can become. So this is not something that we should treat lightly. We do have to have proper information and be able to distinguish between what is true Islam and what is cultural. And what goes against Islamic teachings, even if it is harmless, we say it's harmless, no real harm, we should make that distinction, stand our ground there. If it's not against Islamic teachings, okay, no problem. We also have what may be called adopted practices. One of the well-known practices where Muslim society absorbs from a contemporary society their practices. It's not before and they brought it in with them, but it appeared amongst them and they took it also. We have a lot of that today. But in the past, when 300 years after the time of Jesus, when Jesus Christ was lifted up, Isa alayhi salam, initially Christians did not celebrate birthdays. It was a known pagan practice. Pagans did it. However, they began some 300 years after the time of Jesus, time on earth, they began to celebrate his birthday. They first identified his birthday, the 25th of December, which of course has no evidence, connected to idolatrous beliefs that they had. And that became the standard. They celebrated the birthday, and that celebration became bigger and bigger and bigger. You know, as it spread into other areas, they introduced other things. It wasn't just the celebration of the birthday, you know, giving out of presents that day. Then they brought in the tree from the Scandinavians. The tree came in the house and they put things on it, and, you know, Santa Claus, you know. This is celebrating the birthday of God. I mean, which is ridiculous in and of itself. The idea of celebrating God's birth is, your mind, you have to shut your mind off to accept that, really. It doesn't compute. But that was their tradition. And when it became widespread and strong amongst them, we had some Muslims who felt Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he's greater than Prophet Jesus. So if the Christians can celebrate Prophet Jesus' birthday, then we should be celebrating Prophet Muhammad ﷺ's birthday. We should do it even better. So the Fatimid Shiites of Egypt began the practice 400 years after the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the celebration of the birthday is one thing, but it became a religious rite. And now it is on the calendars of Muslim countries. Wherever you go, you'll find holidays, Muslim holidays. One of them is the birthday of the Prophet. It's become now a standard part of our culture. The problem, besides accepting an idea which is false, the problem comes when people go overboard with this. And the Prophet ﷺ warned us about that. He said, don't go overboard in your praise of me the way the Christians did with Prophet Jesus. I'm just Abdullah wa Rasul, a slave of Allah and His Messenger. However, people went to extremes. We know the celebrations, those of you in your countries, you know what goes on, the parades and the, you know, carrying of objects and all kinds of things going on. And the praises that come, you know, in the various poems and the songs and all of this that comes. So much so that in the most popular poem for the Mawlid, written by Al-Busiri, who is a Berber, he wrote a poem called Qasidat Al-Burda. This is like, he's the 13th century person, from the 13th century. In it are extreme praises of the Prophet ﷺ to the point of shirk. And it is the most popular poem that's read on those occasions. One of the verses, in one of the verses he said, فَمِنْ جُودِكَ الدُّنْيَا وَدُرَّتُهَا وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمُ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ. From your kindness is the world, this world and the hereafter. Saying Rasulullah ﷺ, that from the kindness and the gifts, this is not the total now, this is a part of the gifts of Rasulullah ﷺ to us, is this world and the world to come. I mean, that is so gross. وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ, and from your knowledge, not the totality of your knowledge now, just a bit of your knowledge, is the knowledge of the tablet. You know the tablet? Allawh al-Mahfuz. Allawh al-Mahfuz. Where Allah told the pen to write everything that was and would be. Qadr. Recorded. That is only a part of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's knowledge. وَمِنْ عُلُومِكَ عِلْمُ اللَّوْحِ وَالْقَلَمِ. So the knowledge that was on the protected tablet, as well as whatever the pen knew, it he knows. So these are extremes. This is the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not the qualities of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these represent particular dangers to the ummah, because it affects the deen itself. Among them are religious innovations. under the general heading of what may be called Sufism or mysticism. And mysticism is defined as the experience of union with God. This is the essence of the mystic thought. That the human being's goal in this life should be to unite the human soul with God, with Allah. Now, this is an ancient thought. It's not something new. The Greeks had it before. Plato wrote about it in his Symposium. And the Hindus have it in the concept of what they call Atman, Brahman. That the human soul, Atman, is a part of Brahman. It's one and the same. You hear Christians talking about what is inside of everybody's heart. We all have a piece of Allah in us, God in us. The soul is looked at as a piece of God. And even Muslims have accepted this idea too. That the human soul is divine. A part of Allah is within each and every one of us. Which creates all kinds of problems. Because we know that some of us, and we pray that we are not among them, will be going to hell. So then what are you saying? That piece of Allah which is in you goes into hell, gets burnt? Come on. It's problematic. Doesn't make sense. It's illogical. The soul, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحِ مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّكَ بِعَمْرِ رَبِّكَ. That the soul, that when they ask you about the soul, tell them that the soul is by the command of your Lord. Kun fayakun. Allah commands it to come into existence, it came into existence. It's not a piece of Allah. So, this idea which became widespread through these Sufi circles encouraged this way of thinking that the goal of human beings is to become one with Allah. And with that process, a parallel religion developed. They spoke about the Sharia and the Tariqah. The Sharia was the outer and the Tariqah was the inner. And that knowledge which they got from in the tariqah, it came from special sources. When you'll ask them, okay, so where did this tariqah knowledge come from? They'll say, well, my sheikh had a dream. Or my sheikh's sheikh had a dream. Or they will go back and they say, well, you know, when Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was in the cave with Abu Bakr, he revealed this knowledge to Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr passed it down. They have a chain of narrators. And in the middle of the chain, there is Khidr. Say, ah, Khidr? How did Khidr get in here? Yes, it's Khidr. Still alive. So they have stories to provide a basis for these claims that they make. And they developed a whole system of training oneself spiritually to go through the various levels until you eventually reach Allah. So your goal is fana, where you dissolve into Allah. And that may be preceded by or may be parallel to wusul, where you arrive at Allah. These are the main two thoughts. So those people who were considered to have reached and become one with Allah. And we had Al-Hallaj, who used to say, I am Allah. He used to say that. Ibn Arabi also. He would say that, you are Allah, I am Allah. You don't need to worship anybody outside of yourself. You can worship yourself. is very popular. His writings, his tafsir, Quran. The point is that those people who now claim to have reached that point, they gave them special titles. Qutub, Abdal, various names. But they became special people who were then placed as intermediaries between ourselves and Allah. This is the biggest calamity of that whole system of belief. Intermediacy, where people are placed between us and Allah. Those people they call saints. They gave them the title saints. The Islamic title, awliya. Wali, he's a saint. And we have built huge edifices, shrines, mausoleums over those among them who died of the past. In Ajmer, you have millions competing with Mecca, millions who come there every year to Ajmer in Rajasthan. People doing all kinds of things there, prostrating at the grave, kissing the grave, making tawaf around the grave, writing notes and putting it inside of the frameworks, lattice work that's around the grave, tying it with strings, paying money. It's a business, big business for those people who collect and inform the others that your prayers have been answered, now pay. You know, it's big business. But point is that people caught up in this intermediacy, they no longer pray to Allah. They're praying to other than Allah. They say, well, you know, you are dirty with sin. How can you possibly turn to Allah? Dirty with sin, Allah is pure. So how can you, dirty with sin, now turn to Allah? You need to go to someone who is closer to Allah, who is purer, and that person can take your prayers to Allah for you. Just like if you want to see Sheikh Tamim or Hamad, you can't just go to his palace and knock on the door and say, listen, I'd like to have a little conference with you. No, it doesn't work like that. You have to go to somebody who knows somebody else, who knows somebody else, who's got a connection with this one and that one. And yeah, eventually what you want to do gets to him. It's the same way. That's how life is. But they have sabotaged our relationship with Allah. And the last of the major sources of cultural Islam is religious fanaticism or factionalism. And this is manifest in the madhabs, because this is another area where we run into issues. Where you try to explain something to somebody, they say, ah, you're a Wahhabi. I know about you Wahhabis. Ahli Hadith, they have different names. We are Shafi'is. Or we are Hanafis. We Hanafis do it this way. We Shafi'is do it this way. So this is held up and has become one of the emblems or the symbols of cultural Islam. Because what people are practicing today, they say, I'm a Shafi'i, but Imam al-Shafi'i wasn't a Shafi'i. And the Hanafi say, I'm a Hanafi, but Imam Abu Hanifa wasn't a Hanafi. Because what they're practicing today wasn't what he practiced and taught. Some of it is, but much of it isn't. The schools took on a life of their own. And they became so dangerous to the Ummah that Hanafis refused to pray behind Shafi'is. And Shafi'is refused to pray behind Hanafis. The Kaaba, where people are going for Hajj today, up until 1925, for almost 500 years, had four different salah going on around the Kaaba. If you look at the old pictures before 1925, you will see in the pictures a number of other structures that you don't see anymore. And if you see the titling on it, you will see one structure. It's called Maqam Hanafi, Maqam Shafi'i, Maqam Maliki, Maqam Hanbali. And if you research, what are these maqams? We know Maqam Ibrahim. Everybody knows Maqam Ibrahim in Hajj. But now Maqam Shafi'i, where did that come from? Maqam Shafi'i was the place where the Shafi'i Imam would stand. After the Adhan is given, now time for prayer, Shafi'i Imam would stand, they would make Iqamah, and all the Shafi'is who were making Tawaf, etc., they would come pray behind him. When he was finished, then the Hanafi Imam, they'd make Iqamah, then all the Hanafis would come pray behind him. And then Maliki, then Hanbali. Four different prayers going on around the Kaaba. In fact, even the Hanafis ruled in their books of fiqh that it wasn't permissible for a Hanafi to marry a Shafi'i. That it was permissible for a Hanafi to marry a Christian, but they couldn't marry a Shafi'i. Wow! How far can you go? But this was madhab fanaticism at its worst. So though people make a big deal about the Saudis, you know, look what they're doing, they're changing the haram, they make, you know, whenever they do anything, new building, whatever, people scream, look at them destroying our artifacts. We don't have artifacts. We have no religious artifacts. We have the Kaaba. We make tawaf around it. The buildings around it were built by people and torn down and rebuilt. What people are fighting over right now from the time of the Ottomans, others built before them. The Ottomans changed it. There was nobody crying and screaming when the Ottomans made their expansion, brought in a new design. No. But now the Saudis are the bad guys. So everybody screams on Facebook, you know, whenever any new change takes place, these Saudis are just destroying the religion. Reality is that 1925, when the Saud family took over Arabia, they tore down all those maqams and they said, one imam. End of this. They ended it. So if that's all they did, they got us all to pray behind each other again, I say, Alhamdulillah. Jazakumullah khair. So, the madhabs, it's not to say it's wrong to follow a madhab. Following a madhab is like following a scholar. That scholar is going to have a madhab. Meaning that you don't have knowledge, you depend on him having more knowledge, you trust him. When you need to do something, he advises you to do it this way or that way or the other way. You don't have enough knowledge to go and find otherwise. You follow him. So you are following his madhab. Simple as that. And if you move someplace else and you find another scholar, then you ask that scholar, he tells you something else. Maybe he tells you something different from which the first scholar told you. He gives you some evidence, sounds right to you. You follow him? No problem. Allah says in the Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلِ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask those who know if you don't know. Now, this was a problem for me. When I first came into Islam, I accepted Islam in Canada. And the people that I met when I first came into Islam were Hanafis. I went with Jamaat Tabligh and so-and-so. They taught me and sat with the Maulanas, took my notes. And they told me, yeah, there's 4 madhabs. But most Muslims are Hanafis. Most Muslims are Hanafis. That's cool. And Imam Abu Hanifa, he is Imami Azam. That's his title. The greatest Imam. Of course, they're the ones who gave him that title, right? So I said, made sense, okay. Since most Muslims are Hanafis, I'll be Hanafi. So what was the big deal? Well, at that point, the big deal was the Salah of the female Hanafi. Salah of the male, no big deal. You put your hand down below your navel and you don't raise it when they say Allahu Akbar, okay. No. But the Salah of the female was acrobatic. If you didn't learn it from childhood, you would be falling all over the place. And I had to learn it to go teach my wife because I couldn't just tell her. I had to learn it. They taught me, I learned how to do it, you know, until I could do it properly. And I said, okay, I took it back and taught it to my wife. Of course, when you go into the sunnah, much of what the woman does, the female, the Hanafi does, is against the sunnah. Rasulullah says, don't put your elbows on the ground. They say, put the elbows on the ground. Don't put your chest on your thighs. Why they put the chest on the thighs? Everything that the Prophet said, don't do, they said, that women, you do that. Yeah. So, Hanafi. Then I moved near to a different masjid. Imam there was from Egypt. And he's teaching me further. I'm learning fiqh sunnah, studying. Then I start to notice this is different from what he said, Shafi'i. Shafi'i. Oh. I thought it was all the same. Anyway, fine, Shafi'i. They were bringing the evidences, you know. With the Hanafis, they were just saying, do, don't do. Do, don't do. With this Imam, his father was a scholar from Azhar. So he was saying, here's the evidence. Allah said, Messenger said, so and so. So that's good. Then after that, I met some brothers from Morocco. I found them doing other things, praying with their heads by their side. What is this? They said, Maliki. That's when I decided, you know, if I'm going to learn this Islam, I'm not going to be able to learn it from these people here. I need to go back to the sources, you know, where Islam started, go back to Medina and go study there. That's what drove me to go and study from the source. And ultimately, I should say that contradiction that I saw was a part of it. The other part of it that was problematic was that they taught, everybody agreed, that it didn't matter which madhab you followed. They were all the same. They're all right, right? Although they told me most Muslims were Hanafis, leave that aside. But still, if you choose to be one of the others, it's okay. They're all the same. All were right. But then, when I studied with Shafi'i, Imam, he said that if a man accidentally touches a woman, he has no wudu, and she also has no wudu. But the Hanafis said, if a man accidentally touches a woman, his wudu is not broken, nor is hers. So here came the problem for me. One said you had wudu, the other one said you didn't have wudu. So if you are to accept that both of them were correct, it means it is possible for you to have wudu and not have wudu at the same time. That's like the Christian three gods in one. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Three gods, but no, it's one. For you to accept that, you have to turn your brain off. Right? Your brain says, no, it's three, not one. Same thing. You have wudu, you don't have wudu. Your brain says you got to have it or not have it. You can't have it and not have it at the same time. So one's got to be right. So this was the other element which sent me searching. So in the end, the difference is amongst the scholars that people created madhabs about, which they became rigid in following. Those differences were natural differences. Because if you ask, what was the madhab of Abu Bakr? He was the best of the ummah after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So surely his madhab should be the best. You ask, what was the madhab of Abu Bakr? Was he a Hanafi? A Shafi'i? A Maliki? Hanbali? Those people who are hard into madhabs, they just look at you and say, you're just a problem. You just want to make problems. Why? Because they knew he wasn't any of them. Okay, what about Umar? No. Uthman? Ali? Nobody can make that connection. They were not any of the four. And as I said, even Abu Hanifa was not Hanafi. Imam Malik was not Maliki. Al-Shafi'i was not Shafi'i. Ahmed ibn Hanbal was not Hanbali. So then what were they? What was Abu Bakr? What was the madhab that he was following? Anybody here know? What was his madhab? Huh? Huh? The madhab of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That was his madhab. His madhab was the madhab of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was trying to follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So was Umar, Uthman, Ali, the Imams. That's what they were trying to follow. So there's just one madhab. The madhab of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's all there is. Now the scholar who is teaching you, he will teach you as best as he is able to determine from the information he has gotten, etc. And you follow him. And you're following his madhab to follow the madhab of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's where it ends. These are the areas of traditional Islam. We need to understand them so that if we are caught up in them, we need to let them go and find correct Islam. If we have understood and we are trying to share our understanding with those around us, then we need to be aware of the backgrounds, where these things are coming from, to help people understand, to be patient with them, to understand where these things came from. We need to be understanding. We don't need to be hard, you know, either you follow this way or I'll have nothing to do with you. No. So the only way forward for the ummah, for us to come together and solve the problems that face the ummah today, is to clear away that baggage that we have inherited of traditional and cultural Islam, which goes against the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah. What is acceptable, we accept. And be able to go along with. And when we learn the deen, we learn it in its fullness. In a number of places I've been to, in West Africa, where some brothers from Morocco, they came and they prayed, led the prayer in one of the masjids. And at the end of the prayer, when everybody is expecting the imam to say, Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah, Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullah, the imam said, Salaam alaikum. He didn't finish the salah. They didn't know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam ended the prayer on more than one occasion simply by turning to the right and saying, Salaamu alaikum. End of prayer. So where you don't know, then this can look like somebody is changing the religion, they're innovating, they're doing something. You know? So this is part, we have to be open-minded, we have to be tolerant, we have to be understanding, and we need to increase our knowledge. And alhamdulillah, the Islamic Online University is one of the sources for you by which you can increase your knowledge from your homes without having to stop everything you're doing and going back to another school again. No, you can do it from your home, in your spare time, on the weekend. This is an opportunity to help us fulfill the motto of the university, changing the nation through education. This is the main risala or message that we are seeking to convey and to apply, changing the nation through education. As we know, Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيْرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيْرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, that Allah doesn't change the condition of a people until they change themselves, change what is within themselves, from good to bad or from bad to good. So for us to change from bad to good, we need knowledge. Knowledge is something that is now available to us on a scale unknown before, unimaginable. Before, the only way for you to get the knowledge was to take trips halfway around the world, go on journeys. When you read the life of Imam Bukhari and the other great scholars, it was arduous. Today, it's at your fingertips. The same place you go for Facebook, Skype, whatever, you can go the same place and learn Islam. Learn more about Islam. And alhamdulillah, I'm proud to say that the students in the Islamic Online University, 50% of them are women. You know, usually in Islamic universities, women are small numbers. In the countries that I've visited over the last couple of years, I visited maybe 15, 16 different countries, and I would ask them, is there an alima amongst you? And they would say, we don't know of any. But the first generation of Islam, the fourth most prolific narrator of hadith, teaching us virtually a quarter of the Sharia, was Aisha radiallahu anha, Salama, and how many other Sahabiyat were engaged in spreading the knowledge from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But today, we can't find the alima. So one of the goals of the Islamic Online University is to revive and to bring back in the midst of the ummah females who are scholars, females who have knowledge that they can guide and raise a generation that would understand Islam and be able to change the world, inshallah.
Seeking knowledge and obligation made easy. thought about studying for a long time? Tuition fees keeping you from actually starting? Islamic Online University has led a revolution in online learning. The world's first tuition-free degree, BA in Islamic Studies. Access the knowledge, any place, anytime, anywhere. It just doesn't get any easier than that. Classes, texts, assignments, completely online. Set your own schedule for the semester. No overseas travel required for the exams. Subjects taught by qualified English-speaking scholars. Weekly live sessions in virtual classrooms. With curricula based on those in Al Madina University in Saudi Arabia, Al Azhar University in Cairo, and other reputable institutions around the world. Why wait any longer? You pay just a symbolic registration fee and are ready to begin the adventure of higher education. The most diverse student body of any university in the world. 130,000 plus registered students from 217 countries. Log in to the website for more details. www.islamiconlineuniversity.com.